Ladies and gentlemen, I apologize to Governor Carter for very briefly deferring the scheduled discussion. I do this to report on the future firing line. As many of you know, the Corporation for Public Broadcasting declined to make a grant to continue the program for reasons it was at pains to state had no bearing on the quality of the program. At their meeting 2 weeks ago, the Corporation failed to reach agreement concerning alternative means of financing. Accordingly, we shall attempt during the next fortnight to syndicate Firing Line by offering it to every public television station for the ensuing season. If the stations are able to respond, we shall continue on the air. If not, this will be the penultimate program of Firing Line, unless Governor Carter wants to invoke the doctrine of interposition. James Earl Carter, Jr. startled the country and possibly even some of his constituents by opening his inaugural address as governor of Georgia with the statement, "I say to you quite frankly that the time for racial discrimination is over." Considering that the governor's predecessor was Lester Maddox and that there was no revolution between the end of his predecessor's term and the beginning of his own, the transition was a remarkable feat of social history. Governor Carter simply doesn't spend much time nowadays talking about racial problems. It is his thesis that Southern governors nowadays face other problems, such much the same as those faced by governors of states outside the South. The evolution of welfare policies is one example. Jimmy Carter was born in Georgia, attended briefly the Georgia Institute of Technology, and went to the United States Naval Academy at Annapolis. He intended to make a career in the Navy, but when his father died, he retired from atomic submarines, and in 1953 began a career as a peanut farmer and warehouse operator in which he prospered. He went to the Georgia Senate in 1962 and began his long campaign for governor in 1969. He is a Baptist of firm conviction. Although the economic situation in Georgia is greatly encouraging, it has its slums and its welfare problems. And Governor Carter, like everyone else, has ideas on many subjects, including the subject of a welfare reform. Just to get a little perspective, I should like to begin by asking Governor Carter whether he thinks his fellow Democrat, Senator George McGovern, made constructive welfare proposals during the campaign last year.
No, I don't believe so. If it was intended to be constructive, I don't think it was accepted constructively by the American people. I thought it was a terrible mistake for the Democrats to nominate George McGovern, although I think his heart was probably in the right place. About a year ago, I started a campaign among the governors, at least, to tell them about the devastating consequences of nominating Senator McGovern. I think that his own proposal at that time to have a guaranteed minimum wage, I mean a guaranteed minimum annual income, was very similar to what President Nixon proposed from Mr. Moynihan. But the Congress was not in a proper attitude to add 17 million new welfare recipients as would have been required with Mr. Nixon's program, and neither were they nor the American people willing to put everyone in the nation on a $1,000 a year gift from the welfare program as proposed by Senator McGovern. So this is a complicated mechanism that is extremely necessary, Bill, in the lives of many people who are dependent on it, but which has very little support from among the majority of Americans who are able to work for a living and who have the inclination to work for a living.
Well, but your recommendations are presumably not based, at least not exclusively, on what it is that the American people want. As a governor, you occasionally feel surely the afflatus to tell them what they ought to want. Now, yes. Ought they to want a guaranteed annual wage?
I don't think so. I've been extremely critical recently of President Nixon's
role in Watergate.
Well, as a Democrat, I that's been some interesting news for me. But I hope they don't involve President Nixon personally. I think it would be a blow to the nation. But I think his extremely misleading attitude toward revenue sharing, where he takes money to give to local and state governments under the guise of wealth of revenue sharing, and all of the money comes from the people who are legitimately dependent upon the government to help them overcome some sort of an affliction. In Georgia, we don't have any welfare program for able-bodied men at all. And the only able-bodied women who can qualify for welfare are those who have dependent children. And I might say that for a woman with four children, her maximum payments are about $1 a day per person, which is certainly no bed of roses. But President Nixon has in his latest rulings through Mr. Weinberger, done away with the option that a woman of this sort has, who may have been on welfare for all of her life, and who now can put her kids in a daycare center, get a job. But if she makes the minimum wage, then according to the latest rulings of Mr. Weinberger and the HEW department, she's no longer qualified to put her kids in a daycare center. And this is a kind of obvious conflict that I see. I think that the welfare program ought to be designed specifically for two reasons. One, to give a modicum, really, of human dignity to a blind person or an afflicted person or one who's too old to support himself. And on the other hand, to be designed to help able people overcome handicaps of training or race or education or economic or social background enough to become self-sufficient. But quite often in recent months, the policies of the federal government has been to attenuate this trend in the welfare programs. And we take a very conservative attitude toward welfare in Georgia. We don't have the fancy additional allocations of funds. But I do think that we ought to provide food, clothing, housing for people who can't afford it, and a chance to be self-sufficient for those who are able to.
Speaking of self-sufficiency and of the enormous progress, economic progress in Georgia in the last few years, is Georgia, how close to self-sufficiency is Georgia in terms of federal welfare? I define self-sufficiency as the state that sends in tax dollars to Washington about as much as it gets in tax dollars back from Washington. You're still below that level, aren't you?
Yes, we are. Each year since the welfare program has started, Georgia's percentage of contribution to the basic program has increased. This past year, we jumped, I believe, from 29% to 31.5%, which means that the state is more economically able to pay an additional cost than it was before. But we still receive more back total from the federal government than we pay in taxes.
Now, explain to me how it works. As I understand it, federal welfare money is geared to a scale that is substantially set by the state itself, so that if you have a fairly parsimonious or frugal or careful, if you like, a welfare policy,
yes,
then that which you qualify for from the federal government is accordingly shaped. Is that correct?
That's right. We are slightly above the minimum federal levels in the state. In the past, we have been, I think, exactly at $1 per day per person for a mother and four children, which is the most controversial part of the program, the aid for families with dependent children. And we've only gone a half dollar, perhaps, for the five of them beyond that point. So we are, as you say, careful or parsimonious in our allocation of state funds. And of that portion, the federal government pays a little less than 70%. The state government pays a little bit more than 30%. In the new federal proposals, as you know, the HEW in Washington will take over the responsibility for the Social Security aspects of it to care for the aged, the blind, and the totally disabled. And the states will continue to administer the program for the dependent mothers whose husbands either are unknown or have left the family in the home. Another part of the program that is of great concern to all of us is that there is no present program whatsoever for an underemployed person, for someone who really tries to earn a living. It may be a mother who has part-time work as a maid in a home or as an LPN or some other thing like that. But there is no allocation of funds now for a person who does have a partial income. And it discourages initiative on the part of many. And it also encourages fathers who are unknown to deliberately leave their families in order to let the rest of their family qualify for welfare assistance. I think those are two of the items in welfare that need to be corrected.
Revised. But isn't it predictable that the Democratic Party, having moved substantially in that direction anyway, is going to be calling at the next national convention for a guaranteed annual wage. Now, to what extent is a Democrat whose inclinations would probably be judged as rather atavistic by some of your northern colleagues, to what extent do you feel bound by the deliberations of the National Democratic Party? Or is it your feeling that that this is really a loose alliance and that your use of the word Democrat has to be tailored to local conditions?
Well, I would defy anybody to discern the attitude of a Democratic Party. And if I think loosely bound is a very loose expression for something that's much looser than you can describe in words. There is no way to describe a Democratic Party policy on welfare. I think, however, that even the most conservative Democratic leaders of the past, Senator Walter George, for instance, and Senator Dick Russell of Georgia, have always taken a posture that a legitimate function of government is to deal with inherent afflictions of people. Senator George considered his greatest contribution to the nation's welfare, although he was chairman of the Foreign Affairs Committee, he considered his greatest contribution the evolution of federal aid to education in the form of career or technical education. And he wrote the landmark bill that's still in effect there. Senator Russell told me shortly before he died that he thought the best contribution that he had ever made was to evolve a free lunchroom program for poor children. I think that that Southern politicians, statesmen, no matter how conservative they might be in their general reputation, have always felt that one of the prime functions of government was to discern the afflictions of a citizen and try to help them overcome it, whether it was retardation in case of a mentally afflicted person, or a lack of education in case of Senator George, or lack of adequate diet in case of Senator Russell's school lunchroom program, or in the welfare program, to give a helpless person enough money to live on. So this might be a Southern characteristic, but they've always been very cautious in it, and I think they've always tried to make sure that the contribution to a person was adequately repaid if the person was able to repay it. Senator George, to train a person to hold a job. We have in Georgia an extremely rigid religious attitude toward a person's work ethic. It's hard to express in words, but the average Georgian feels that if he doesn't do a day's work for a day's pay, he somehow violated his religious conscience. And we have, because of that, eager applicants for jobs in the state. We have practically a non-existent...
In the North, we call that the Puritan ethic.
Puritan ethic. Well, we have a similar one. We live in the Bible Belt, and that's part of it. But we have an unemployment rate in the state of about 3.5%. Sometimes ranging less. And this includes, obviously, students who are not in college, women who work part-time and who have worked in the past, and so forth. But I believe that we consider the welfare program to be part of a manpower development program, or part of an industry recruitment program, part of a technical school or career school program, all designed to help people stand on their own feet, to develop their own individuality, to be self-sufficient, and to play a role in government. And this is the way I look at it. And I think that the average welfare recipient in Georgia, if given a chance, will take training and will hold a job. We've had this proven in a few instances. I can recall one community in the state, Griffin, Georgia, down just south of Atlanta, about 40 miles, where they had a large influx a few years back of textile industry. And we had a fairly high welfare role, and a training program was put into it, and almost all of the women who had children at home who were receiving welfare volunteered to take a training program and went to work. Well, I think you can see that if you are a mother and you love your children and you see your child perhaps doomed to spending the rest of its childhood life at least trying to pay for food, clothing, housing, medicine, school supplies, and so forth on a dollar per day, that just the natural love of a mother for a child will induce her to seek better things for her family. So I believe that the welfare program is obviously necessary. We need to avoid the restraints that prevent somebody from receiving welfare payments if they do try to help themselves. And we need to emphasize the training and job qualification aspects of the program, which hasn't been done in the past.
Well, do you think it's possible to say that that Southern history and Southern culture has resulted in an attitude towards welfare that is in any way distinctive from the attitude in other states? Could it be that you feel in the South an avuncular relationship that was distilled out of your experience with slavery, which now gets transformed to a feeling of responsibility for people irrespective of their color who need help of that kind? And is that different from the kind of thing that would be experienced in Maine or Oregon?
Well, I couldn't judge the rest of the nation. I think that in the past obvious misconceptions of the welfare program have been based to some degree on racial thought, that the welfare program was primarily designed for worthless citizens who didn't want to support themselves. But the facts of the matter is that this is not the case. As I said earlier, there is no program for able-bodied men, black or white. I think another thing that's been obvious in the past is that the South, following the war between the states, did have a great need for gainful employment. We had a lot of small farms, and as the farms were mechanized, there was a choice to be made, and I think we made the right choice in retrospect. One choice was to move into Atlanta or to Chicago or to New York, and leave the farms and start a new life. A lot of the life, as you know, in New York and other places is based on a welfare a recipient role for the rest of one's existence. In Georgia and in many other states and some other states in the South, the people decided to stay at home, and there was a major effort made and still is being made to locate small businesses, small manufacturing firms close to the farm area, which can employ a person who doesn't have any high degree of education nor technological training, but who's willing to work and able to work well with his hands. For instance, we've got a fine textile manufacturing complex in Georgia, and recently we've developed into the nation's foremost producer of mobile homes, a fairly high-paying job, but where the assembly of the mobile homes is done, you know, by hand labor, and the person who's lived his life on a farm can do this.
These are for sale to non-Georgians. The mobile homes, right?
And Georgians, sure.
Except they always stay at home.
That's right. But so instead of moving to Atlanta and living in a 20-story high apartment complex, they stay at home and live in the mobile home that they perhaps helped to construct. But we haven't had the massive move off the farm areas into the cities that other states have.
Well, is Georgia to be distinguished from other parts of the South as not having fed in any way the great migration of black people to the northern and midwestern cities?
No, we fed it for a good period of time that I think ended 8 or 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. There was a migration out of the south. But now, as I say, our unemployment rate in Georgia is 3.5%, which is almost zero. We have a training program, for instance, founded on Mr. George's legislation, whereby if any industry wants to come into a town in Georgia, we'll take their prospective employees, we'll help them select them, we'll recruit them, we'll screen them, and we'll actually train those employees so that the day the plant opens to manufacture whatever, those employees are ready to go to work, already trained on the new plant's own machines. Mm-hmm. And there is a very fine interrelationship in Georgia between labor and management, regardless of whether the labor force might be a member of the union or not. I had executive vice president of one of the major firms down in Georgia the other day who manufactures chewing gum. He had opened a small plant just south of Gainesville, Georgia. 2 years ago, he had originally had 200 employees. He told me that of the 200 original employees, after more than 2 years' time, he still had only lost 5 of them. He still had 195, and he had less than 1% absentee rate. So I think there's an embarrassment, first of all, about receiving welfare. There's a religious belief, as you say, the Puritan ethic, that causes a person to want to work and support himself. Mm-hmm. And there's a natural conservative attitude among the policymakers of the state that hasn't created an attractive welfare program that would keep people from working if they can. But as I say, there are two basic defects in it that I've described earlier.
I know somebody who ran for your office a while back and says he was beaten primarily because he took a theoretical stand against the minimum wage. And it is his position was orthodox as far as economists are concerned. That is to say, you can't find an economist who backs the idea of a minimum wage as an economically defensible proposition. To what extent have you found that nationally imposed minimum wage a retard economic development in your state?
I don't think it has.
How come?
Well, I have a vague memory of the first minimum wage proposal that the Democrats put forward that was opposed by the Republicans to establish a 25 cent an hour guaranteed payment. When I finished high school, I got my first job off the farm, working for the federal government measuring land for farmers, and it paid a 40 cent minimum wage, but I had to furnish my own automobile within the 40 cent allotment. Every time a minimum wage has been proposed, even beginning with a 25 cent payment, it's been characterized by many of our southern statesmen, office holders, as a blow against the South. But I think we've passed a point now where the influx of industry to provide jobs for our people is based on cheap labor or on artificially contrived tax incentives or on deterioration of the environment. And I believe that we are competitive now. We are shifting in our employment habits and our employment achievements from a bare minimum wage structure, where that was a great escalation of what you had received in the past, to one that's based on technology and advanced training. I think we're probably 40 or 50 years behind in some ways the northeastern part of the United States, but we're moving rapidly.
Yeah, you're 40 or 50 years ahead in some too.
In some,
yeah.
I agree.
Well, what you're really saying, as I understand it, is the minimum wage doesn't really hurt you because most people are earning it as a matter of raw economic circumstances. But if you were the governor, say, of Puerto Rico,
yes,
you would probably be opposed to the minimum wage on the grounds that it is an unemployment-making social institution?
I don't believe that I would, but I can certainly see arguments on both sides. My own belief is based on experience, where every time we've had dire predictions of catastrophe if a minimum wage was established, and I've seen it come into a Georgia rural community where there was just one textile industry there that was owned by the most prominent family in the community, who probably already also owned a bank, the Chevrolet dealership, and everything else in the town. And the advent of the minimum wage was predicted as completely destroying the town. Well, it hasn't. And now we've seen interlocking ownership of manufacturing plants, both in the textile field and in many others, where a nationwide salary structure would greatly escalate the salary base in a given southern town when that company put a plant in. It might automatically raise the average salary level for our employees, say $1 an hour, immediately when that new plant came in. And I've never seen a town suffer from it. I've never seen a community economic structure suffer. In my opinion, it's always benefited when the average wage for the working people increased.
Well, it obviously does, assuming that there's an inflexible demand for the product. But when, for instance, they passed minimum wage in Chicago, and within a year, 25,000 people who ran elevators for a living found that they were out of a job because elevators were automated. Mm-hmm. That's a pretty concrete result of a minimum wage. I take it that the situation in Georgia is one of those felicitous ones in which a high and rather vigorous upward-tending economy stays ahead of a minimum wage, that the minimum wage never acts, as I say, as an agent of unemployment.
No, I didn't say that. I think quite often the minimum wage has acted to substantially influence, beneficently, I think, the level of wages paid. I don't know whether it's
true. Well, if it were that simple, why don't we tell the Indians about it? And, you know, there they work for 20 cents a day, not because they want to work 20 cents a day. They'd much rather work for $2.20 a day.
But we're talking about a level of wages that actually is minimal in nature compared to the prevailing wage rates on the average around the nation. I don't think we've ever seen Congress, who are very conservative in this area, wage minimum wage rates above the average wages paid in the nation already.
No, average has nothing to do with it. Certainly not average, but we're talking about the least, the people who are least able to cope competitively in the economy. The classic example is black teenagers whose unemployment went up 100% after the minimum wage hike of the late 50s. Now, maybe your point is, let's go ahead and victimize them because there are other discernible benefits of a non-economic kind. Mm-hmm. But at least let's acknowledge that they're the victims, right?
Well, if you assume that elevators were automated because of the minimum wage.
Mm-hmm, I do. That's what they said.
Well, my own belief would be that elevators would probably have been automated without the minimum wage. But based on that assumption, I think you can certainly build a good case. But I don't think that I've seen any impact, any adverse impact in my own experience of establishment of minimum wages in the neighborhood that we've now witnessed of less than $2 per hour.
And why would there be an unemployment rate of 3.2 in Georgia and an unemployment rate of 10 to 11% in New York City, given the fact that communication facilities between the two places are pretty effective? Why don't people leave New York, where they don't work, in order to go to Georgia, where you can work?
Well, I think, as you know, the minimum wage is the same in both states, I presume, is it not? Well, I think the average wage rate in New York is undoubtedly higher than Georgia. Also, there's a very attractive welfare program in New York, I understand, where people can make a substantial income without working.
So you do think that is a factor? It might have been a factor, for instance, in the emigration of the
50s. The welfare program?
Yeah.
Yes, sir, I do.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think the minimum wage was directly involved in it.
Do you have a residence requirement in Georgia?
Yes.
A constitutional one?
I think it's being challenged.
I see. Mr. Richard Skinner is instructor of history at the University of South Carolina. Mr. Skinner?
Governor Carter, I was interested gathering from your comments about federal revenue sharing. What will be the effect of federal revenue sharing on your social welfare programs in Georgia?
The revenue sharing impact on Georgia has been all negative. We've seen, for instance, an allocation of revenue sharing funds to the state that amounts to $36.6 million a year. We've had direct losses of federal funds that come through our state budget of $54 million, with another $120 million in cutbacks in the state for other things that don't come through our state budget, like the construction of low-income housing and payments to farmers and so forth. So economically, it's been a blow to the state. The most insidious thing, though, about the revenue-sharing proposals has been that although President Nixon And former Secretary of the Treasury kindly assured the mayors and governors that revenue sharing would not be financed out of existing programs. That is exactly what has happened. And we've seen...
You mean financed by deducting from existing programs?
Right, uh-huh. By deducting from existing programs. And the deductions have come from among the people who need the federal funds the most. The retarded children, the student loan program, the payments through the Title IVA programs for mothers who leave their kids in daycare centers, for farm disaster programs. The reason this has come this way is that the federal programs in the field of social and educational effort have been designed historically, ever since, I guess, the time of Roosevelt or before, to fill gaps that existed among programs devised by local and state governments. And quite obviously, those gaps were the ones that provided for the poor, or the defenseless, or the non-influential,
quite often
the black.
Why quite obviously?
Well, because the local and state governments have almost always been orienting their programs toward the average or the middle-class person, or one with
why should state officials be less altruistic than federal officials?
Well, I think state and local officials both have some handicap in seeing things as a broad picture. And also, there's a practical aspect of the effort that works against the poor, because take your Title IVA programs, the welfare payments, the daycare centers, the programs for retarded children. All of those, just because of the description of them, are designed for the poor. Well, now, if the federal government takes the same amount of money and gives it to a state legislature and says, all right, you take this money and you spend it as you see fit, the natural human inclination is to divide that money at least equally among all of its people. They said, we'll give the poor so much, the rich so much, and we'll build some golf courses, we'll give some tax refunds, and so forth. And the money is coming from the poor programs for the poor. And even in the most benevolent circumstances among a state legislature, the money is going to be oriented toward treating all the people of the state the same. So it's being taken from the poor and at best divided equally among all the people.
But I think it's rather an interesting generality that you're making, that the further removed you are from a retarded child, the more likely you are to pity him. Why would that be so?
Well,
I should think that a state legislature would be much more concerned over the distinct social problems in its state than you could ever expect a rather aloof government in Washington to be.
Well, in the case of a retarded child, I think you'd be right. But in the special education programs, the Title I, the Title III, the Title IV programs, and others, these were designed specifically for the economically handicapped children. They're administered by state education departments, but they're designed for experimental purposes. The Head Start program is designed with a limitation on economic income for the family for the child to qualify. The same thing applies, of course, with the welfare program, with your manpower training programs. These programs that are designed to help a person become self-sufficient or to receive some compensatory education naturally accrue to the people who can't finance it themselves, or who can't go to a private school, or who can't go to a private sanitarium for treatment. So that the nationwide programs in the field of health or education or welfare or labor are naturally designed for the poorer people.
Well, let's go on to Miss Margaret Young, who's an instructor in foreign languages at the University of South Carolina.
Governor Carter, since most people on welfare are women, do you see the welfare problem as related to other problems women face in our society, such as job discrimination, child care, exclusion from decision-making positions in most institutions?
Well, in fact, they're mostly children, aren't they, rather than women?
Women with dependent children.
It's aid to
families.
But it's
aid to the children via the mother, right?
Right.
In effect, but it's the women who are heads of the families that are receiving the money. Mm-hmm.
It's the women who bred the children.
That's true.
That's part of that inequality.
That's right. I doubt if we could change that circumstance, that the women are the ones who produce the children, but as you
George
know...
George McGovern forgot to change that.
And I hope... but I think it is... Obviously, the case that the welfare program, as it has been designed by Congress and as it has always been administered, so far as I can remember, is designed to provide funds for a mother with children only if her husband, common law husband or official husband, has departed, either dead or has left the family. Mm-hmm. Quite often this departure is a subterfuge. The husband might be lurking in the background waiting for the welfare supervisor to look the other way. But it has prevented the family from being reconstituted if the father is present. And
it's atomizing in its implications, isn't it? Yeah. Why don't they change it? You know, I've never heard anybody in my entire life defend this thing, and for some reason it doesn't ever get changed.
You know, I think the reason for it is that there's a hang-up against paying any sort of welfare payments to a man who's physically capable of working. So the Congress apparently has just simply said, well, this man doesn't exist as far as the children are concerned, and they require legally that he not exist as far as the welfare supervisor is concerned. So in effect, he's wiped out of the family picture by law, and in order for his family to qualify for the very minimal welfare payments available, he has to be absent from the home. There is also a prohibition in the welfare program of making a payment to supplement wages earned by a head of the household. If a person goes to work and earns a minimum wage, there is no provision under the law for that person's income to be supplemented by a welfare payment. And the most recent ruling of the under the Title IVA program has further exacerbated this particular instance, whereby, as I described, a welfare mother who can now leave her kids in a Title IVA daycare center, if she earns a minimum wage, is by definition or regulation disqualified from leaving her kid in the welfare center any longer. So she honestly has only one choice. She has to take her kid out of the daycare center, back home, and go back on welfare. So we've had this.
I mean, if she earns a minimum wage for 40 hours a week, right?
Right.
You don't mean if she earns a minimum wage but has only part-time work?
No, if she earns a minimum wage for 40 hours a week, mm-hmm. Yes.
Well, might they be trying to say that people who earn the minimum wage ought not to be burdens on other people who are merely earning the minimum wage? And since any archaeology done on the collection of dollars shows that quite poor people are paying very considerable taxes.
Yes.
There's an attempt there, isn't there, at rough economic justice?
It would be.
Well, why should you tax?
Yeah. Rough economic justice, because a mother with four children, who's earning say $2,500 a year, would not pay any income tax.
So she's getting relief from that at that level.
Yes.
As opposed to a woman who had no children would be paying tax.
That's right. There's another very peculiar ruling that I can't understand that President Nixon or Mr. Weinberger has promulgated, and that is that in the 75-25 matching formula under Title IVA, if the local people have raised the money privately, if a group of mothers who have, say, the retarded kids we mentioned earlier, have raised this money with cake sales or with basketball games or by public subscription, then they cannot any longer use that privately raised money to match the 75% that comes from the federal government. And those locally initiated.
It's got to be state tax money to qualify for the 75%.
Yes, now in Georgia, because we don't have.
It doesn't sound very Nixon-ish, does it? I mean, he'd be very much in favor of cake sales and things.
Well,
so am I.
Apparently he isn't, though, because this is the regulation that was promulgated by the Health, Education, and Welfare Department this past January. If any portion of the local matching fund comes from private sources, you can't qualify for the federal fund.
Is this a way of trying to discipline the states, saying to the states, we don't count it as you doing your effort if, in fact, you are not doing it, but you are requiring, you are using the private ingenuity of people to do it for you? Is this the thinking behind that?
I honestly can't understand the motivation of it. Mr. Carlucci, who was formerly the head of the OEO program, who then went through the Office of Management and Budget And then he wound up in HEW, so I guess the OMB experience may have changed his attitude. But this has been the case. I don't think it's a matter of disciplining the states, because most of these particular programs are direct contractual arrangements between the local community itself and the federal agency.
Well, then, in that case, trying to discipline the local community.
I presume so.
Even though they bought the cakes.
Well, I think the motivation for it really was to save money, because, as you know, that the Title IV-A program, which was growing by leaps and bounds and needed some restraints, was approaching a point of about $5.5, maybe $6 billion. The Congress last September said that we're going to put a $2.5 billion limit on it. And I think what Mr. Nixon and them tried to do was to pass regulations that would prevent even the expenditure of the $2.5 billion.
I see.
I believe that was the motivation.
But Ms. Young, you wanted to make sort of a feminist point here, and I think we didn't really sort of derailed you.
I did want to see if you thought it was related to like job discrimination, since women have trouble getting into high-paying jobs. So that frequently this mother you were talking about would have a great deal of difficulty earning enough to justify her going off of welfare.
Yes. I believe that's part of it. You know, I've served in the legislature and now as governor. And I believe a great deal of the opposition to women's rights, even the group that can recruit women to fight their battle for them, I think it's economically motivated. I think there's a great deal of opposition to seeing women paid the same wages as men for the same work. I don't think I've answered your question.
That's the beginning.
Okay,
yeah.
Great.
I think you won that one, didn't you? Mr. Jeffrey Stafford is instructor of government at the University of South Carolina.
Instructor of history.
Oh, I'm sorry. You have a question, Mr. Stafford?
Yes. Actually, either of you gentlemen can take a whack at it. It seems to me that discussions on national welfare policy almost inevitably get bogged down in details and the frittering away of certain details. Well, our president told us when he was elected that he was behind the Protestant ethic, the Puritan ethic, workfare, not welfare. And he was going to propose a whole series of revisions if the Congress would act on this. Apparently would clarify the problem and clear it up. Two parts to a question. First of all, do you think that President Nixon's attitude in this revision of the national welfare policy was skillfully enough motivated so that it wouldn't pass in the first place, as some of his critics point out, you know, putting a floor under poverty, guaranteeing a minimum annual wage? Or do you feel that it was a specific enough proposal to work if, in fact, it were passed?
Well, Moynihan wrote a whole book about that. Yes. Go ahead.
I was hoping you'd answer that one. I don't.
Oh, either gentleman.
It's hard to say whether President Nixon was sincere when he proposed his welfare reform bill. It was done with a great deal of fanfare, as you know, and got headlines all over the world, I presume. And then he's hardly mentioned it since. I think it was discerned that it would cost maybe additional $4 billion a year and would add about 17 million people onto the welfare rolls that weren't presently there. So that was the end of that as far as President Nixon was concerned. I think there's a gross example of mismanagement within the Nixon administration that prevents their discerning what are good portions of a program and which ones ought to be cast aside or supplanted by improvements. And there's a twin responsibility in management. One is to have the mechanism of government as efficient and effective as possible, and is open to the public and is amenable to public understanding and persuasion as possible. And the other one is to legitimately discern the needs of the people and try to deliver those needs in the most efficient way, but with a compassion for their needs and with a real inclination to overcome a handicap that a person might serve. But there is no effort been made, so far as I can see, to discern what parts of the welfare program are working and do need to be maintained, which ones ought to be cast off or replaced. And the same thing exists in the field of manpower training, where some aspects of manpower training, a preparation for jobs, are very efficient, and others are very inefficient, and the whole thing might be wiped out. In the OEO program, which is not a popular program with the people, the poverty program, there are some aspects of it that have been very, very helpful in providing health services for people that never would have had it otherwise, and in providing jobs for people who never would have held jobs otherwise. But simply to terminate the entire program, because there's no ability to discern what part of it ought to be mm-hmm. maintained, is the breakdown that exists now. Another very serious problem is that the local, state, and federal agencies must work together. In the past, I and the other 49 governors have been able to guess, at least, what would be the attitude of the federal government by seeing what bills passed, what bills were vetoed by the president, what funds were appropriated, what funds were signed into law in the appropriations bill by the president. Then we could make our budget determinations accordingly, submit them to our state legislatures, many of whom don't meet but once every 2 years, and proceed accordingly. Now, with impoundment and with this extreme secrecy that isolates the president and his decision-making leaders from the public or from Congress, there is no way for us to predict what's going to happen in the future. And many of the states have been caught in an almost untenable position, having prepared its budget and passed it, and then have the federal funds completely changed or abolished. Hmm. We have, I think, the worst interrelationship now between state governments and the federal government that we've ever seen before. There's a complete breakdown.
But isn't that the penalty for over-reliance on the federal government? Now, maybe that's a requirement in Georgia. Georgia, being substantially below the national average in per capita income, but I don't see why in California, for instance, if they find that there are aspects of the OEO program that they like to perpetuate, they can't go ahead and perpetuate it and do it more economically than they used to do it by sending money to the federal government, only a percentage of which flowed back.
Well, I think, as you know, we still send money to the federal government. This is the federal government's financial base is not is not removed from the Georgia taxpayer. You know, we pay the same rate of taxes as anybody else in the nation.
Yeah, but there's less surplus.
And there's a contractual arrangement in many of these things where Congress over a period of even generations has evolved a working relationship between the state and local governments on one hand and the federal government on the other. We'll pay 50%, you pay 50%. Certain requirements have to be met. Well, we build our state budgets on that basis. There's been a greatly escalated income to the state government, although we've been lucky enough in Georgia to reduce taxes recently. We still have about a 16% or 17% increase each year in revenue, which we spend for the people. But the shock of it, that after the fact divulging of a secret decision, completely contrary to the expressed will of Congress, is the thing that has created difficulty with the state. It's not an over dependence on the federal government. It's a contractual relationship between the two. And we are picking up part of the programs that were formerly within the OEO realm. For instance, as a last act before our own Georgia legislature adjourned about a month ago, we voted $12 million to care for the training of afflicted children to supplant $13 million that had been snatched away by the federal government at the last minute. But states don't have unlimited funds, and the problem is that with a certain increase in the gross national product, say 100%, local governments
with the gross what?
Say with a 100% increase in gross national product, local governments' income based primarily on property tax only goes up 70%. The state government's income based on a combination of sales tax, income tax, and so forth on average goes up 95%. The federal government, based entirely on the very progressive income tax, goes up 130%. So with a given increase in gross national product, which inexorably occurs, the federal government is much more able, taxing the same people, you and I, me and you, to finance new kinds of programs. It's not a matter of the states and local governments not being willing to do our share. It's just an inevitable part of a nation's tax structure.
It's not inevitable. It's a psychological relationship. Psychological relationship which you invited. There's nothing in the tax code or in the Constitution of the United States that allows the federal government to preempt the taxing power. You can do anything you want to with your state income tax, and in fact the federal government rather obligingly allows your taxpayers to discount all state taxes from taxes paid to the federal government. But surely what you're pointing to is an attitude of dependency that has stripped the state of the kind of initiative, one of the effects of which is the recent arrogance of Mr. Nixon in playing the particular games he's playing. Mm-hmm. It seems awfully odd to hear from a Southern governor that the federal government will continue to exercise all of the initiative in deciding how much tax. Because
well, you know, I didn't say that and don't say that at all. Mr. Nixon doesn't, and the federal government doesn't have the right to take any initiative in the tax structure of the state. But the point that I'm making, obviously inadequately, is that over a period of years, the interrelationships between the federal and state and local governments have been promulgated first and then accepted as a part of our economic life. And then to have decisions made in secret at the last minute, after many state legislatures have already adjourned, and said we are canceling this program, which was approved by Congress, vetoed by the president, and then overridden.
No, I agree.
You know, this is the kind of thing.
Yeah, false reliance, the lawyers, I guess, would call it. I think you're quite right. That kind of thing oughtn't to be done. But it's also, I'll just say one more time, because I'm not saying it very successfully either. it is too bad that the federal government is in a position to do that to you. In point of fact, as we all know, the state taxes have risen much, much more than federal taxes in the last decade. And account the state federal revenues are equal to 20.3% of the GNP, and state and local taxes are equal to almost the same.
That's true.
But the point I want to make is that suppose there were only two states in the union, Georgia and New York.
Yes.
What we're really talking about is how much New York money is going to come into Georgia. This is really what it comes down to. And I think it helps to view the situation as a synecdoche, so that you don't have the comfort of that economic blur that makes people feel that just by turning that faucet, money is spontaneously generated and flows on into Georgia. Mm-hmm. Every time the federal government does something for Georgia, it is taking away from somebody else, isn't it? I'm not saying necessarily it shouldn't.
Well, you know, when you say the federal government does something for Georgia, that's one thing. I think the federal government is dependent on the people of Georgia and the people of New York for financing programs of all sorts. Let's take, for instance, the interstate highway system. This is a...
There they pay 90%, don't they?
Well, the point is that everybody who buys a gallon of gas pays 4 cents.
Mm-hmm.
A New Yorker pays 4 cents, a Georgian pays 4 cents, and simply because there are more people in New York doesn't mean that the New York taxpayer is taxed heavier to pay the highway system. But the point is that when we pay in our 4 cents into a trust fund, Congress said by law that money should be given back to the states, partially, 90%. The states put up 10% to construct the interstate system that was designed under the Eisenhower administration. And then Mr. Nixon impounds the funds. You know, this is what creates havoc within a state highway department, which is trying to work out long-range acquisition of rights of way, design mechanisms, and so forth.
Yeah, but wouldn't you say that is in flux in Washington now? It is by no means clear, is it, that he's going to get away with it?
No, but
meanwhile, there's chaos.
But he has gotten away with it for 4 years and a little more. I think there have been two court test cases, both in Missouri, originated by Missouri, and both of them have ruled that the president did not have the right to impound funds against the expressed will of Congress. But it's a losing proposition for the whole nation. Not only are the people deprived of a right to ride on interstate highways, but the cost of construction of those highways goes up about 9%. And we're delayed now, I presume, 4 years from constructing highways in Georgia.
Sure.
Now, we've taken action on that. Mr. Nixon has withheld $47 million of money that we consider to be ours,
mm-hmm,
from the Highway Trust Fund. Well, our Georgia legislature, at my request this past month, allocated the sale of $60 million worth of bonds to be paid by the Georgia taxpayer to go ahead and complete the interstate system. And we figure that later on, several years in the future, when the federal highway funds come to us, we can pay off those bonds. But here's a case of a state taking the initiative. But I don't consider the federal government to be doing the Georgia state government a favor when it sends our gasoline taxes back down to Georgia to help construct the interstate highway system.
No, but after all, we're talking about 90% now. Yes. Versus 10%.
But the money was paid 100% by taxpayers all over the nation, regardless of what state they happen to live in.
Well, you'd have to trace the inequity. Essentially, you've got a situation where if the government pays 90% of the cost of anything to a state, it's going to encourage that state to have a spree in that department. It's very hard for the state of Georgia or the state of Mississippi not to allocate a considerable amount of its money towards the building of highways. Yes. If 90% of the revenue for them is going to come from outside of Mississippi.
But now the 90% only applies to the interstate highway system, which was approved 8 or 10 years ago by the federal government. As you know, the whole interstate network was laid out and approved by the Department of Transportation in Washington. We have to build the highways between the points as prescribed 8 or 9 years ago
but what I'm saying is that you're going to give a priority for highways over against, say, schools, precisely because there is such leverage that you have. Well, and this is an example of how hierarchies are dominated by federal dispensation, isn't it?
Well, theoretically that's true, but both the federal highway funds and the state highway funds in Georgia come exclusively from taxes on gasoline. The people that ride on the road pay for it, and I think this is a very proper allocation of funds.
In other words, if you don't raise the money that you desire from gasoline taxes, you just don't appropriate it.
That's exactly right.
Well, I think that's a very good system.
Yes.
Congratulations. Mr. Skinner.
Mr. Buckley's comment about the the welfare process whereby funds are channeled through dependents to dependents,
yes,
and that creates atomization of the family unit. Doesn't that seem to provide an argument for the allocation of funds on a family basis, either on the McGovern plan or on some other plan, whether it's guaranteed or not?
Well, the way I understood Mr. McGovern's plan, I think he had several. The one that former Vice President Humphrey publicized so well in California was that every person in the nation would be allocated, I believe, $1,000 per year. Affluent people from New York and poorer people from
Georgia.
Poor
people from Georgia.
And then on that $1,000, you would pay an appropriate amount of income tax. The wealthier people would pay 60 or 70% income tax on that dollar and only keep 30 cents, whereas the poorer people would keep the entire dollar. And this was one approach to it. It was very similar in theory, I think, to the plan that was developed by Pat Moynihan, and proposed by President Nixon. It's just a guaranteed minimum annual wage. But the Congress was not willing to do it because it would have taken up a great deal of additional welfare recipients throughout the nation and would have cost a good bit more. If I remember correctly, the Nixon proposal would have cost about $4 billion more than it presently cost. I don't remember the figures on McGovern's program since it wasn't ever put to a...
Well, you take 1,000 and multiply by 200 million people to begin with, right?
Right.
And then you subtract whatever you get back in taxes and so on and so forth.
That's true.
I think they got... As a matter of fact, I think he withdrew it, didn't he, towards the end?
Yes, he denied that was his real plan. That
he was going to send it back to Harvard for more study.
I think so.
Yeah.
And he said originally, really, to be fair to him, that he had three or four plans, and that particular plan was just one they were considering, but it was the one that was most obviously disadvantageous politically.
Yeah.
And it was one that Hubert Humphrey publicized quite well.
Thank you very much, Governor Carter. Okay. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen of the panel. Ladies and gentlemen.
Bound copy of this program, send 25 cents in coin to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. That's 25 cents to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250.